Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chanzom. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Monday, the 28th of September. Protests against farm bills intensify in parts of India. Activists urges UN to protect religious minorities from persecution in Pakistan. And Taliban says intra-Afghan negotiations should be based on agreement with US. And now for all the details. Protests by farmers and opposition parties intensified across India on Monday against contentious farm bills that have become laws now after President Ramnath Kovind's accession. Various farmer groups called for a statewide shutdown in southern Karnataka, and demonstrations were held in different parts of the country, including capital New Delhi.
Protests by farmers and opposition political parties on Monday intensified in parts of India against the newly passed farm bills that have now become laws, a day after President Ramnath Kovind gave assent to all the three contentious bills. Various groups of farmers called for a statewide shutdown in southern Karnataka state and staged demonstrations throughout. Prime Minister Narendra Modi's government insists the new rules give farmers the option to sell their produce to institutional buyers and big retailers. However, farmer organizations have argued the laws could pave the way for the government to stop buying their produce at guaranteed prices, leaving them at the mercy of private buyers.
It's pro-corporate bill, pro-corporate bill. The government is misled to farmers, not misleading the farmer leader.
Meanwhile, workers of opposition Congress Party set a tractor on fire near the famous India Gate monument in capital New Delhi on Monday morning as a part of the protests, leaving it charred, after which five people were arrested. Police also detained some protesters belonging to the Congress Party who were trying to organize a protest in the national capital.
कांग्रेस पार्टी सड़कों पे उतरी है पूरे देश में जब तक ये काला कानून वापस नहीं लिया जाता तब तक ये संघर्ष चलता रहेगा
प्राइम मिनिस्टर नरेंद्र मोदी हैज मेंटेन्ड द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ द लॉज इज अ हिस्टोरिक मूव एंड द ऑपोजिशन पार्टीज आर मिसलीडिंग द फार्मर्स
India's Health Minister Dr. Harshvardhan on Monday inaugurated the vaccine portal for COVID-19 to create awareness among masses. Indian population is still far from achieving herd immunity against COVID-19, the health minister had earlier said, citing Indian Council of Medical Research's second sero survey. Meanwhile, India's coronavirus case tally topped 6 million after it reported 82,170 new infections in the last 24 hours.
India's Health Minister Dr. Harshvardhan on Monday inaugurated the vaccine portal for COVID-19 to create awareness among masses. The portal will disseminate vaccine-related information regarding Indian efforts towards vaccine development against COVID-19. The Health Minister said the first vaccine would likely be available in the first trimester of the upcoming year. India, which has the second highest number of coronavirus cases globally, on Monday reported 82,170 new infections in the last 24 hours. The case tally stands at 6,074,703, including 962,640 active cases. Total recoveries from COVID-19 crossed the 5 million milestone, with recovered cases outpacing active cases by more than 5 times.
देखिए केसेस की जो संख्या है उस पर आप मत परेशान होइए. आप देख रहे हैं कि देश में 82-83% लोग ठीक होकर घर जा चुके हैं. एक्टिव केसेस तो अभी 6 मिलियन में शायद 1 मिलियन के आसपास ही हैं. और ये भी सब रोड टू रिकवरी की तरफ है वैक्सीन के खोज की दिशा में बहुत तेजी से प्रयास हो रहा है
Harshvardhan earlier on Sunday said that the Indian Council of Medical Research or ICMR second sero survey shows that Indian population is still far from achieving herd immunity against coronavirus infection. The Health Ministry in a statement said that ICMR is actively researching on reports of COVID-19 reinfection, and although the number of such cases is negligible at this moment, the government is fully seized of the importance of the matter.
Moving on, activist Anila Gulzar has urged the UN Human Rights Council to intervene to protect religious minorities from persecution in Pakistan. Speaking during the 45th UNHRC session in Geneva, she highlighted abductions, forced conversions and misuse of blasphemy laws against minorities in the country.
Human rights activist from Pakistan Anila Gulzar has requested the United Nations to intervene and protect the rights of religious minorities in Pakistan, as they have been facing persecution in the country for the past 7 decades. While speaking during the 45th UNHRC session in Geneva, Anila Gulzar highlighted cases of abductions and forceful conversion of girls from minority Hindu, Sikh and Christian communities in Pakistan, and also the misuse of blasphemy laws against them in the country.
A lot of Christians have left Pakistan due to fear being prosecuted by blasphemy law. They are sitting in Malaysia, Thailand, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka. Every year, Christian, Hindu, and Sikh girls are kidnapped and forced to accept Islam and marry Muslims who have kidnapped them.
The activist also raised the recent case of a 37-year-old Christian man named Asif Parvez, who was sentenced to death after being falsely implicated in a blasphemy case, as he refused to convert to Islam. Human rights defenders say blasphemy laws are often misused to persecute minorities to settle personal rivalries. Islamist extremism has been on the rise in Pakistan, and such accusations can end up in lynchings or street vigilantism.
Human rights activists for years have shown concern over the growing state-run violations of human rights in Sindh and Balochistan. The Baloch Human Rights Council and the World Sindhi Congress recently held a joint protest outside the UN building in Geneva against the institutionalized state violence of the Baloch and Sindhi people by the Pakistan military. The Baloch Human Rights Council and the World Sindhi Congress held a joint protest outside the UN building at the Broken Chair in Geneva during the 45th session of the United Nations Human Rights Council against the institutionalized state violence and other forms of social, economic and political suppression of the Baloch and Sindhi people by the Pakistan military. The protesters called the United Nations and the international community to live up to their mandate and commitments without any hindrance and political pressures, and make Pakistan, which is a signatory to various human rights instruments, to end its genocidal policies in Balochistan and Sindh.
They abducted Saran Choyo, who was having camps for the release of missing persons. Now they have abducted Mohab Azad, Secretary General of the Sindh Sujagi Forum, because he was raising the voice. So not only they are abducting those who are raising the voice against the injustice, against the atrocities, but they are abducting those who are raising the voice for this.
Baloch and Sindhi pro-freedom organizations recently announced their union under one umbrella to find the bilateral China-Pakistan Economic Corridor or CPEC project. According to them, Sindh and Balochistan are equally affected by the expansionist and oppressive resolves of China. Through CPEC, China aims to subjugate Sindh and Balochistan and occupy the coast and resources from Badin to Gwadar.
In news from Afghanistan, the Taliban has insisted that recognition of Doha Agreement signed with the United States in February is the key to move forward in the current intra-Afghan talks in Doha. Negotiators have been holding talks to reach an agreement about the procedural rules for formal talks. However, no consensus has been reached so far.
The Taliban has insisted that without recognizing the deal with the US as a main foundation of the peace process in Afghanistan, the continuation of current intra-Afghan talks will have no meaning, Afghan media reports said. The intra-Afghan negotiations should be based on the Doha agreement or part of the agreement which was signed between Taliban and the US in February. Abdul Salam Hanafi, a member of the Taliban negotiating team, was quoted as saying by local media reports. Taliban spokesperson Dr. Mohammad Naeem on Twitter said the contact groups of both Taliban and the Afghan government had a meeting on Sunday evening to discuss working principles or practices before setting an agenda for negotiations. Almost 2 weeks have passed since negotiators began attempts to reach an agreement about the procedural rules intended to guide the formal talks. However, no consensus has been reached so far. In the latest, Dr. Abdullah Abdullah, chairman of Afghanistan's High Council for National Reconciliation, on Monday reached Pakistan for a 3-day official visit, with Afghan peace process being the top agenda, as the neighboring countries seek to iron out bilateral issues, while Afghanistan is chasing a peace deal that may end 4 decades of civil war.
India has announced a grant assistance of $15 million for the promotion of Buddhist ties with Buddhist-majority Sri Lanka. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi made the announcement during a virtual bilateral summit with his Lankan counterpart Mahinda Rajapaksa this past weekend.
Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, while expressing special priority, has announced a grant assistance of $15 million for the promotion of Buddhist ties between India and Buddhist-majority Sri Lanka. Speaking during a virtual bilateral summit with his Lankan counterpart Mahinda Rajapaksa on Saturday, Modi said India will also facilitate the visit of a delegation of Buddhist pilgrims from Sri Lanka in the first inaugural flight to Kushinagar in Northern Uttar Pradesh state. $15 million grant will assist in deepening people-to-people linkages between India and Sri Lanka in the sphere of Buddhism through construction or renovation of Buddhist monasteries, capacity development, cultural exchanges, archaeological cooperation, reciprocal exposition of Lord Buddha's relics.
भारत और श्रीलंका के बहुमुखी संबंध हजारों साल पुराने हैं. मेरी सरकार की नेबरहुड फर्स्ट नीति और सागर डॉक्ट्रिन के तहत श्रीलंका से संबंधों को हम विशेष और उच्च प्राथमिकता देते हैं.
मोदी ऑल्सो कॉल्ड ऑन द लंकन गवर्नमेंट टू एड्रेस द एस्पिरेशंस ऑफ द तमिल पीपल फॉर इक्वालिटी, जस्टिस, पीस एंड रिस्पेक्ट विद इन अ यूनाइटेड श्रीलंका, इंक्लूडिंग बाय कैरिंग फॉरवर्ड द प्रोसेस ऑफ रिकंसिलिएशन विद द इम्प्लीमेंटेशन ऑफ द 13th अमेंडमेंट टू द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ श्रीलंका. Rajapaksa expressed confidence that his government will work towards realizing the expectations of all ethnic groups, including the Tamils.
Engaged in a conflict with China in recent months, the Indian Army's armored regiments are ready to take on the Chinese army at altitudes of over 14,500 feet along the line of actual control in eastern Ladakh. The Indian Army is also working on war footing to fight the extremely harsh winters by building new shelters and prefabricated structures for the soldiers. Indian Army conducted an exercise in the high-altitude Himalayan deserts of Ladakh on Sunday after it deployed tanks at highest possible altitude in the world to manage Chinese border situation. Russian-origin T-90 and T-72 tanks of the Indian Army and BMP-2 infantry combat vehicle participated in the drill near line of actual control or LAC at Chumar Demchok area in eastern Ladakh territory. The Indian Army is also working on war footing to fight the extremely harsh winters by building new shelters and prefabricated structures for the soldiers.
Training and honing of crew skills and drills will remain a constant throughout the winters. The Indian Army in eastern Ladakh is logistically well prepared.
Tensions at the India-China border increased after Chinese transgressions in multiple areas in the Indian territory. The Indian Army, in response to the aggression shown by the Chinese, has deployed more than 50,000 troops along with heavy weaponry, including artillery and tank regiments, to tackle the enemy forces.
Both countries have since said they are attempting to resolve the situation through diplomatic and military channels, but talks appear to have made little headway so far.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/AsiaNewsline and follow us on Twitter at AsiaNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We'll see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button. Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.